Rastafari is kind of just gone. All right, so we're gonna touch on we want to touch on continue with the Devar Torah. I think this will be 44 point two, so it'll be the third lesson. Now Devar is very interesting. I want to introduce this, even the meaning of Devar, the word Devar. Now Devar, as we see it right here, Devar, Devar, as in Devarim, the Yod Mim, or the Yod, the Y, and the M, translated here with a Y sound, a Y or E sound, and the M, the Meh, right? That makes it plural, like Elohim, plural, right? When we are going to the biblical Hebraics, that plural rises it. So Devar means, Devar equals word. So let's put word right here. We want to go through this teaching here so we clear this and we can get more into and touch on the tribes. Because we touched on it briefly when we had an inspiration to speak on Rastafari Judahites and Benjaminites. Because they're very important to the unity of Beta Israel, or the so-called Afro-American Negro, or Negro black and colored, the so-called Yankee. You know, with the Yankee and the Yardie, Inja must unite. There's a purpose that we must fulfill. And we're not willing to be that generation. Jah can make the stones do his work. In other words, he can, in other words, we can be replaced if we're not willing to make our wills obedient to his good influence. You understand? To study and to grow, and to actualize, to act on the knowledge, to truly act knowledge in word, right? In the Devar, in the word, and in the deed. So the word comes first. Because the word, when we think thoughts in terms of words. So we can think either words of life, right? Or we can think words of death. We can think truly God words. Now, word also is called logos, logos, and this is important to connect with this. This is why I think that this particular defining the name of this Torah portion, we hopefully once have read the Torah portion for this week's reading and feeding, and you know we're in another book. We're in the book of Deuteronomy, and we're going to show you Deuteronomy right here. Let's show you Deuteronomy right here, Devarim, or the Hebrew book of Deuteronomy, all right, because education is the key. Yosef, education is the key. We must know these things. But if we don't know them, how can we act on them? How can we manifest them? It's like having a will. Like if you had a relative who, let's just say for the sake of this reasoning, a relative, right, and the relative had to so-called die. So the relative died, and they had a will, right, and the will was not open. It's like when we talk about the book of the seven seals, the will was not opened, you understand? But then there would be whether an executor or someone of the estate who therefore had to go forward with the lawyer or the advocate and then to open the will. Now, if the will was open and you know you're an heir, wouldn't you want to read and to study what is in that will? Well, this is the case for I and I. We need to study what is in the will, you understand, of His Majesty. So what would the will of His Majesty be? And we saw a very interesting article about Kennedy and the silver. I think Ashra Kwasi is either in Ethiopia, because Egypt is kind of off limits, and I'm kind of happy about that, because now folks, whether they were willing or not, they're going to get to the root of the matter, or hopefully they'll have the opportunity of getting to the root of the matter. Now for us, we know the root of the matter is the Metav Kedus, is the Book of the Seven Seals. All right, now this particular cross is the Ethiopian unilateral cross. You can see it's almost like a square right there. It's equal on all sides. It's not like the unequal or the inequality cross of Caesar. It's not Caesar's cross. It is Christ's cross. So we as the Beit Israel have to recognize who we are, who we were, and how our ancestors said that they have no God but Caesar. That's all we've been on the subject matter of what race is Christ and whether the race of Christ really matters. Some say that it doesn't, and that is anti-biblical. And if it's anti-biblical, basically it's anti-Christ because it goes contrary to his word. Now, so this is the Torah portion reading and feedings right here. And now this particular book right here is interesting with this stuff about Kennedy and the silver. Remember this right here, Betrayal of Ethiopia. All right? And His Majesty's visit was, what, 50 days before Kennedy was assassinated. You understand? Now, what was discussed in this particular meeting? Well, we just heard that the papers of John, the brother, have been sealed up. But here on the writer, Asafar Deferis, and you should try to get a copy of this. This is printed by the American Ethiopian Press. See if there's copies of this available. You need to get a copy of this, The Betrayal of Ethiopia. It's a very eye-opening, honest report, eye-opening in so many ways, and definitely it's a book that we need to be talking more about and see if we get copies of this. But let's go into this Torah portion. And we want to touch on the mystery of Devarim and the Deborah mystery. Now, Deborah, if you look it up in the Bible dictionary, they probably will have the meaning that it means a bee, right? And that is what it means. But now we need to understand this holistically. Now, a lot of talking about agriculture. Now, we know that the bees are very important for agriculture. And if you've been watching the news, you've been hearing about the drought, because drought is coming. You know, we're trying to remind ones about this, and you can look at some of our old papers at the LOJSociety.org. And if you go there, you know, we have a wealth of a lot of the older papers that we wrote, and we saw this drought coming. I guess a lot of folks saw this drought coming. It's interesting, is a particular paper that we wrote is called Signs of 1995. 1995. Some will say, well, you had it, you was off by some years, 1995. Well, that is the grace of God, but we didn't say it was happening in 1995, but we said some signs to look forward to. And it's very, very interesting because, see if we have a copy of it around, but we'll go into that, signs of 1995, you know, because we're seeing certain, you know, prophecy on the horizon, you know what I'm saying, concerning us. Now, we've also been touching on Jeremiah chapter 20, I think it's Jeremiah chapter 23. So look at Jeremiah chapter 23, take a study of that particular chapter, because it is speaking to us. If you have a Schofield, the notes there are very important. But let's touch on Devarim, right, Devarim and the Deborah. You understand? Let's call it the Deborah or Devar mystery. Now, Devar means word. Devar means word. Right? Now, word in the Septuagint, the Greek, right? The scholastic, intellectual language, it means the logos. Logos, and logos means word. You understand? And word is the key, is the real key to this mystery. It's the real key to the matrix. You understand? The real matrix is the word. You remember, I've said this to a couple of brothers and sisters I've been reasoning with. I said, you remember the movie Matrix? And the movie Matrix, you remember when Neo got to a certain point? Neo symbolizes when it's interpreted Christologically. And if you haven't seen The Cannabis or read The Cannabis Matrix, I suggest you get a copy of it. But since the compilation from some of the online essays, you can probably go on the internet. But I think if you want to have a good carry-along copy, it's very good to have a copy. It's a well-printed, well-compiled book, if I may say so. and those who have checked it out can best speak for it themselves. But in the Matrix movie, right, when Neo got to a certain point of consciousness, as he was growing in his consciousness, interpreted Christologically, as he was growing in Christ consciousness, he was able to actually see the Matrix. He could see the code in the living, in the illusion around. He saw it through the illusion, and he could see the word. That's important because everyone else that was a part of, you know, the Zion, right, they still were behind computers. So they was behind their computers, but he could see this code. That it's a very interesting matter there, but we know that there's a black Hebrew, an Ethiopian Hebrew sister, Sister Sophia, who was really behind that, you know, and her testimony is a powerful testimony, but it's another confirmation of it. So let's get into the word. Now, Devar, when spelled D-V-A-R, if you look it up on the Wikipedia or whatnot, Devar in the Hebrew means word. Now, they have Devar Torah. Devar Torah is basically what we have from an Ethiopic perspective. And what is Devar Torah from an Ethiopic perspective? Well, the Devar Torah from an Ethiopic perspective is like a sermon, a lecture, a reasoning on a particular Torah portion. That when we gather together in our minyan, you understand, of at least 10 faithful brothers, you understand, and this is how actually, when we call it public prayer, where we pray in public, or we form something that is in the spirit of the covenant, you understand, whether for the community or for worship, there needs to be 10. That's where they get the whole idea in the world of a board of directors, from this number, particular number, 10. Now, we know with Christ, there was the 12. But it's very interesting to understand that the 10 came before the 12, right? When you say Israel, you could say Asar El, and that means the 10 tribes. Now, remember, there was a difference between the 10 tribes, North Israel, right, and Judah in the south. But it was to Judah in the south that monarchy, you understand, of David was given, and where Yahweh made a covenant with David and with his seed. Now, in Rastafari prophecy, we know that the fulfillment of this particular covenant, you understand, in our day and time, the revelation of it is in the King of Kings. It's in the King of Kings. It's through Ketamawi Haile Selassie. Right, I think this picture was either Negu Sefarai. There's two particular pictures. One is Negu Sefarai, and one is when he was King Sefarai. And it's very interesting what was happening side the real in Europe. Because in Europe, if you recall, in 1928, Rastafari became King Negu Sefarai. And then when you look in, I think, 1929, the Pope, he became, in a sense, king, right? So when the Pope saw that Jah was making his move, right, he basically tried to make his counterfeit move, right? And then in 1930, His Majesty now, with a new name, Ketamawi Haile Selassie, fulfilling Moa Anbesa Ze'im Negeda Yehuda, which says, weep not, because we out here in the diaspora, you understand? We saw that positive sign. You understand? And this is what's so very important when you recognize that the coronation of His Imperial Majesty had a resonance among black people. You understand? Black people, and this is before internet, this is before this multimedia, the 24-hour cable news networks or whatever, CNN. Before all of that, we recognize it. So this is where this man, Dr. Malakou Emmanuel Bayan, he becomes very important in this equation because he's the one that Ketamawi Haile Selassie sent to the black African Americans to Judah. He sent this man to Judah, and Judah is a so-called Afro-American Negro. And for the Israelite brothers, it's very interesting. You might not have known this, but a brother from Montserrat, he was the first land-grant administrator, you understand? But he was like the only Hebrew, but he was there representing it. And it's so interesting that there was this one man. It reminded me of Gedaliah. Some of you might know of Gedaliah in the scripture, when the Israelites were taken into Babylonian captivity around, I think, 580 6 or around them parts, that was also a Tisha B'Av incident, that there was one person that was left behind in Judah, in Judea. There was one particular, and he was Gedaliah, right, or Gedaliah, right, and what had happened to him and how they hated on him. It's kind of interesting when you see the scriptures and then you see things happening and you begin to recognize, you know, the wisdom of God, the Word, the Devar. You understand? The Devar, the Logos. Now, yes, sorry. Now, Christ says, Yeshua says, the Moshiach says, that you search the scriptures because you think, like in them, that you have eternal life. And Christ says, these are they, right, which testifies of him. You understand? These are they which testify of Yeshua HaMoshiach, right? So he is called the Logos. Remember, Christ is called the Word. You understand? And the Word of God became flesh and it dwelt amongst us. You understand? And he often has said to the faithful Judahites, if you believe, if you accept that's true, if you amen my word, and my word is in you, then you have life, then you are overcomer. You understand? So the word is so very, very important. Now, here we want to go with this word, Devarim, and the connection with Deborah. So we know that Devar, right, Devar, or just D-V-A-R, a contracted Devar, Devar, right, means word. And now, let's go to the scriptures right here, and we're going to have to begin with Deborah, right? Let us begin with Deborah. Actually, we can begin with Debir, Debir, right? Let's put Debir right here next to Debar, right? Let's slash this, and let's put what we have in the scripture, D-E-B-I-R. Now, we already made this connection between the biblical Hebrew, right? We also can make the connection, in the Amharic, but really coming from the Ge'ez, we have De, right? De, Bir, Debir, right? And then when it's Debre, right? And this means a mountain, right? A mountain or a monastery, right? A mountain. It means a mountain or a monastery, right? A mountain or a monastery, a Debir, and you have Debreh, like Deborah Damo is a mountaintop, flat top, like Mount Sinai top kind of mountain in Ethiopia, which is also a significant sign, symbol, or witness. That's why Jah chose that place. That's why the psalm that says that this man was born there. There's some people who still are struggling over Zion. What does Zion mean? Stay tuned for reasoning on Zion, on the two Zions. And there's a whole deeper picture to that that even connects with the fallen angels, but also connects with Christ overcoming them. You understand? So you got to stay tuned for the two Zions right there. But right here, Debir, right? Debir, and we're in the Metaphysical Bible Dictionary. It says that this means the Debir in Hebrew, it's a Hebrew word, so we see the link between Hebrew and the Ethiopic, right? Which both are Afro-Shemitic, if you study this linguistically. Debir means the innermost part of the temple. The innermost part of the temple. The sanctuary. Place of oracles. It's the place of words. So where the Holy Ark of the Covenant is, where the sacred scriptures is. If you go to, say, an Ethiopian church and a priest would go in the, you know, in that holy place. That's symbolic of the Debir, right? And it also means speech. It means oracle, right? Which is another word like oracle, like oral, the mouth, oracle, the word, right? So it means word. Now, when we look at scripturally, there was an Amoritish king who was the king of Eglon, who was defeated and slain by Yehoshua, or by Joshua, by Old Testament Joshua, in Joshua 10 and 3. Then there was a city of Judah in Joshua 15 and 7 that is also called Kiriath Sana, or the cities of Sana, Joshua 15 and 49, and it's also called Kiriath Sefer, S-E-P-H-E-R. Now, Sefer from the Hebrew also refers to the scripture. You understand? And it's kind of a link with the Ethiopic there, too. That's in Judges 1:11. Now, there was another place by this name that was allotted to God, or Gad, the tribe of Gad, right? In Joshua 13 and 26. So that gives us now the historical of this one right here, Debir, right? The Debir, which is similar to Debir, which is a mountain, and also in the Ethiopic sense is a monastery. But we know it refers to the innermost part of the temple, the sanctuary, the Mekdes, the place of oracles, the place of words. Now, I want you to understand this not just in terms of Old Testament, you know, Old Testament kind of, just Old Testament. You have to see this in the New Testament in the living way. Because remember the word, remember how we take in word. Remember what David says in the psalm, that I've hid your word. You understand that they said, I've hid your word in my, you know, within me so that I don't sin against you. He's hid that word. It's that word. And Christ says, if my word be in you, if you make my word, put my word in the sanctuary, in the heart. So this is like the heart of the temple, the heart of the tabernacle. It's called the Debir, right? The Debir. Now, metaphysically speaking, right? Metaphysically. So we just gave you the physical of it, right? The Old Testament sense, the physical. Now we're going to the metaphysical, right? The metaphysical. Now, Debir, in its highest significance, is the most secret place within the very center of man's being. So now we know that this Devarim means words, right? Then we know the Debir is the innermost sanctuary, right? And in Ethiopic sense, in Tewahedo sense, in the Ritua Haimanot Tawi sense, it's a mountain, flat top mountain, like the Close Encounters kind of mountain, right? It's a monastery, right? A mountaintop monastery, but it the significance is the innermost, right? The significance is, in its highest significance, is the secret place within the very center of man's being. So you have to ask, so what sort of words do you have in the very center of your being? Do you have Jah's word? Do you have Jah's peace? Or do you have a lot of worldly stuff? You understand? Polluting your sanctuary. So it's the Holy of Holies where God dwells, where Jah dwells, where we can commune with him. So that's why I say when we pray, we're not praying throwing words at the wall or throwing it out the window or throwing up in the sky. You understand? It is an inward, you understand? It is an inward communication. We're communing, you understand, coming into that unity with that word in the centermost, in the heart of our being. That's what it says, that Christ, he stands at the door and knocks. You understand? Because that word desires to enter in, but it's I who can open up the door or keep the door closed to that word. It also refers to the Christ. So in the Metaphysical Bible Dictionary, published like 1931, 1 year after His Majesty coronated as King of Kings, conquering Lion, the tribe of Judah, King of Israel, of Zion, of Sion. But then what's interesting, in 1931, His Majesty proclaimed the Constitution. You understand? The first Constitution in Ethiopia's history freely. You understand? So we also have this book coming out, which is, and they just republished it in the 90s. So for a while, they suppressed this particular book, the Metaphysical Bible Dictionary. You can get a free download of it at our website, www.lojsociety.org. Click on the study page link. So this refers to Christ, to Christos, the Moshiach, or to the Christ mind. It says, let this mind, the Bible teaches, let this mind be in you. As this mind was in Christ, as he be, so are we in this world. You understand? And it's through that word, which is the word, right? And from which we receive our what? Revelations of truth. It's through the Word. The Word become flesh. We eat the Word metaphysically, spiritually, in its truest essence. There's no other way to describe how we take the Word on. We eat the Word. You understand? The Word becomes one with our being. And through the Word, we now have the Kabbalah, the true Makevel, you understand, of our revelations, of the true revelations of the truth. Because now it's the Spirit. It's that anointing. Now it says, Kiryat Sefer means the city of instruction. The city of instruction is Kiryat Sefer. It really means the city of books. But see, it's the book. What are we talking about? The will. It's the book, which is that instruction, right? Which is that instruction. That's why, as Matthew said, it made education so very important. Because we need that education so we have the opportunity to come to the truth for ourselves, you know, of our own free will. And so this city is a center. This city is a center, right? It's a center of learning, a place where understanding is attained, and it is very sacred. It is very holy. That means it's set apart from the world. It's of the family. It's of the Beta Rastafari. It's of the Beta Israel. It is not of the world. When the cities named Debir belong to the Canaanites. Now, Canaanites, the Kana'anu mean, in one sense of Hebraic interpretation, means the lowlanders. But now when you understand that metaphysically, it means those who are on the low level of consciousness. They're like semi-conscious, or they go in and out of consciousness, you understand? Or they are just totally unconscious. So when these cities, when these holy places now, which is likened to the words, are in the possession of those of the Kana'anu, lowland consciousness, they signify the state of mind in which man is ignorant, where man is in ignosis, where man is a nice guy, you understand, is ignorant of the true source. He's ignorant of the Ahadu Amlak. He's ignorant of the true Amlak. He's ignorant of the true source of inspiration and truth, the true source. So he thinks the inspiration comes from this, from that, the next, but he don't recognize it comes from that Word, and that Word being the Moshiach, that Word being Yeshua. You know what I'm saying? That Word being His Word is the true source of inspiration and truth. When he is in this unawakened state, he's a sleeper, right? When he's in the unawakened consciousness, man defies, as it were, human methods of learning. And we've been trying to remind the brothers and sisters that even with the gift of tongues or of languages, that I clearly am able to demonstrate through that anointing, through the Holy Spirit, it's not of I and I labor. This does not mean that we do not study. But we, first of all, must know what to study. We study His Word. So here we're coming like full circle. You understand? This is a cipher or a sefer. It's an instruction. It is a open book, right? So when man is in this low-level, unawakened consciousness, he deifies, as it were, human methods of learning. It's like saying, go to school and become an educated fool, as it were, because you're just going to school so you can get good jobs, so you can pay off the loans, and you know, like, you spend half of your life stressing out to make the money, and then when you get the money, you spend the rest of your life trying to pay your doctor's bill and get your health back. But see, health is the real blessing. But in this unenlightened state, man worships that which is created. You understand? What's created instead of the creator. And we have a perfect example even right now in this technological society. People worshiping the created instead of the creator. The outer effects and methods instead of the one source, instead of the Ahadu Amlak, instead of Yahweh Ahad, instead of the Ahad, the one, right? Now, Debir, the king of Eglon, who was an Amoritish ruler, remember we were talking about the Amorites, he represents the central ruling thought. So now, metaphysically, he represents a central ruling thought of the sense man. What is What is the sense man, or what is the sense mind in man? The sense mind in man is where you only rely, or you deep end on the five physical senses. That means you depend on the physical seeing, but no spiritual sight. You depend on the spiritual, on the physical hearing, you understand, but not the spiritual hearing, not the Shema, you understand? And on the same thing with the taste. You can't taste the spiritual. You can't taste the word because you never put the word in your mouth. You understand? You know, you can't smell the word, you understand, like smelling a rose or a flower or the it's a feris, you understand, or the it's the herb. You understand, that sweet herb which is likened to this thing, glomardium. You cannot smell that. It smells awful to you. You know those people who kind of hate the herb, the sweet herb smell, something, I don't know. It's just interesting. You know, that's a whole other point. And the touch, you depend on the physical touch, the sensation, and get caught up in carnality because you have no spiritual sense of touch. So that is what Eglon, in that sense, represents, that particular ruler, right, is the central ruling thought of the sense, mind, and man regarding that which is most sacred from a worldly or seclorum point of view. The creative power of the word. The creative power of the word. This thought brings the highest truth of spirit to a very material basis. Now, I've been noticing this. I don't know if y'all been noticing this too, that they be having a lot of these ads nowadays. These ads look a little bit like spiritual, or they may have like yoga or something, but they're selling a product. They're using like kind of spirituality-ish. It's like when you see these Negroes in the so-called Godspell, you understand, type of churches, and they be like doing like the McDonald's commercial, these other kind of commercials, and you'd be like, yo, what's up with that? And then you be thinking this is a mock. It's a mock choir. But no, it's sometimes a real so-called, quote, church choir, and they're using, it's like they're singing a gospel song about the Big Macs and the fries, you know, like that really saved their life. And remember, who did that? It was Esau. Esau gave up the heritage. He gave up the barakat for something to eat. He kind of sold, and you know, you start to look at that and see where the lost sheep will are. And it's an eye-opener for those who can see spiritually. Some folks still don't get it. They're like, huh, well, what does that mean? They didn't really get it. So keep them in your prayers. But Deborah, right? Deborah now, the next part of this, Deborah means B, right? B-E-E, you know, the bee, the honeybee, right? But it can also mean a wasp. Right? Because the bee and the wasp are very kind of similar, but one makes honey, one doesn't. You know, now, the bee is the leader of the flock. In that sense, bee and Deborah is interpreted here as leader of the flock. And also, Deborah is, the bee is also one of the followers. So this is interesting because the bee, therefore, can be both the leader, right? Can be the leader of the flock. Or the bee can also be the follower, you understand, of the flock. So that's kind of interesting how the bee, you understand, is in whatever capacity it needs to be, it be that, you understand, the bee. It can be the leader, it can be the follower. Now, Rebecca's nurse in Genesis 35 and 8 was called Deborah. She had that name. And there was a prophetess of Israel. There was a prophetess, yes, sisters. The role of woman in the Bible, listen to this. Deborah was a prophetess of Israel who with Barak, right, with Barak, not Obama Barak, but this Old Testament Barak, delivered Israel from Sisera, right, and his host in Judges chapter 4, verses 4 to 16. Now, other branches and other forms of Judaism, you know, they have the Song of Deborah is something that's chanted, and the Song of Deborah, I don't know if you sisters have ever checked it out, but if you're checking this out, check out the Song of Deborah. It's very interesting. Hopefully we'll touch on that, but let's get into the metaphysical of this. This is a little bit longer, you understand, than the Debir. So we understand that the Debir is the innermost. So symbolically, it is that sanctuary. It is our heart. You understand? This is why when we read in Romans 10, right? Let's turn our Bibles for a moment to Romans 10, 10 and 10. What does Romans 10, 10 say? Romans 10 says, for with the heart, right, the innermost, the debir, you understand, with the heart, the inner sanctuary, with the heart, man, it uses the word believeth, but man amens. Man has a trust, a faithful witness, right, with his heart, his consciousness to righteousness. Now, that righteousness is our black Lord and Savior, Yeshua HaMoshiach, is the Jesus Christus in spirit and in truth. You know what I'm saying? So recognizing his Ethiopianness is important. Why? Because it's the truth. You can't talk about this Caesar Borgias. We know that it's a Renaissance painting, 15th, maybe 15th or 16th century or so, and there's been a lot of versions and off of that, you know, but we know that was a fake. You know what I'm saying? We know exactly that is not Yeshua. That's not a Jesus. That's not Jesus even. You know what I'm saying? That is Caesar Borgias, Borg. You know what I'm saying? And whoever's into that is like the god of this world. It's the Borg. They're going along with this Borg programming. So you can see how even their own testimony and witness, it bears witness to the truth. If you love the truth, then you'll be able to, you may not like what you find, but still the comfort should be the truth. Now you know. Now you're not in ignorance. Now you can realign yourself according to the truth. And with the mouth, it says, confession, right, is made to salvation. With the mouth. So well, it's interesting when we compare this with the former reasoning on what race Yeshua HaMoshiach was, and one of the signs in the Antichrist is to say that the race of Jesus doesn't matter. Because we see on one hand, it's a heartical thing, like a spiritual thing. It says not about the outer, but it's about the heart. Okay, we agree. It is about the heart. But now if the confession coming out your mouth is saying it doesn't matter what race, you're saying it doesn't matter what seed, it doesn't matter that he's of the seed of David, but it does matter to Jah. So I and I will bear witness to Jah over somebody who says they have faith in this book, but haven't even taken the time to study it and to accept the truth in it instead of to twist it. You understand? And then on the second part it says, and with the mouth confession is made to salvation. So you can see how it's like twofold, spirit and truth. In spirit in their heart and in truth with their confession. Because some would say, well, yeah, I believe in this in my heart, but what comes out their mouth is the word. You understand? Ones have to learn, we all got to learn to prune our words. And if we check our speech, it's like the Rastafari said it, word, sound, and power. You say, where did that meditation and reasonment on that go? Where did that groundation go to? It must be returned. It must be restored. It must be renewed. But let's get into Deborah, right? The Deborah mystery. What is the Deborah mystery all about? How does Deborah now connect with Deborah, Debir, Devar, Devarim, and this Torah portion, which is the Hebrew book of Deuteronomy? You understand? Deuteronomy on the Ethiopic, Orit Zedagim, right? Orit Zedagim means the Torah, the Orit of the repetition. And it's the repetition of the law. But what does the law contain? The law is contained in the words, the divine oracles. So we got to recognize, you understand, that particular connection right there. So Deborah, metaphysically, right? Deborah means a bee. Deborah means a bee. Bees are noted for their fine sense of discrimination. Bees are noted for their fine sense of discriminating. You understand? Being able to distinguish or discernment. And for their great activity. And they do work. You understand? The bees, like busy as a bee, right? Rebecca's nurse, Deborah, she symbolizes a very active, sustaining soul quality, a very active and a sustaining. That word sustaining is so important because in the Ethiopic, Igazi Abeher, more correctly, would be translated as sustainer, the one who sustains. So nowadays, as we're getting to this new age, people talk about sustainability. Well, if they're not connected into true source, there's no true sustainability. All they're thinking about is material sustainability, fleshy and carnal sustainability. Well, what about the spirit? What about the soul? You know what I'm saying? Those don't perish with the material things unless they have not been invested in. You see, if you don't invest in it, you can't get anything out of it. All right, so Rebecca's nurse, Deborah, she symbolizes a very active, sustaining soul quality. And then they say, see, Alon, Alon Bakut, Alon Bakut, in parentheses here. But we'll go to that in a furthermore. It's going a little more on that aspect, if you want to get into that particular aspect, the very active and sustaining soul quality. Now, the prophetess, Deborah, she represents judgment, which is based upon spiritual discrimination. Spiritual, not racial discrimination, not what color, if you light or dark, no, spiritual. See, we're to have discrimination, but not this evil kind of, this evil deception, lie, you know, white supremacy, and then getting evil, getting equal with the devil and stuff. It, you know, don't make no sense. That's part of the deception, to keep you at a Canaanite level. There is in everyone a fine sense of discrimination. We all, in one way or aspect or another, have a fine discrimination, you know, about things. A keener perception than is known to the five senses. So it's a keener way of perceiving that goes beyond, now we're seeing this, beyond the five senses, which is the higher way now of looking at the word, at the logos, at the devarim, or the words, or the oracles, right? The oracles, right? The oracles of Jah, right? So it says, when this faculty functions in its native state, and in its native state, in its natural state, in its born state, and for us in that reborn state, under its own palm tree, in connection with wisdom, in connection with what? So we have the word, but the next, the wisdom is the principal thing. Wisdom is the principal thing. And for disciples, Dekam is Amorit, in addition to the daily psalms, the daily psalm chanting, reading, and study, please study Proverbs. Proverbs is one of the basic books that the Adis met, that the newcomers, or that the new brothers and sisters, like the young ones, as we're studying in order, the Psalms, the daily Psalms, and the Proverbs are like regular, it's like breakfast, you know what I mean? Like, eat that like breakfast, you know? Lapidote, her husband Lapidote, the husband of Deborah, his name was Lapidote, and that is said to connect now with wisdom. Now, marvelous results were attainable, right? Because she was like that bee, and her husband was wise. So together as one, the male and the female, together as one. Now, Deborah dwelt under the palm tree of Deborah. She didn't dwell under somebody else's palm tree. You understand? It's like for I and I, as Rastafari, or just as black Christians, the Ethiopian Christian, why should we have a 16th, 15th, 16th century Roman Catholic whitewashed Jesus, who is Caesar Borgia, the illegitimate son of Pope Alexander VI, as Christ? Or why should we have his daughter Lucretia, you understand, as the mother? You see what that does to the psyche? You understand? You see what that does to the, well, first of all, it's not true. And then for us, since it's putting into us the image of the beast, you understand, the image of people who were not living on the level of God's people, but still were living down to their carnal, their animalistic nature. You understand? They did not gain mastery. You understand? Now, they were always wanksters on a spiritual level. Deborah dwelt under the palm tree of Deborah between Rama, or Rama, and Rama means a height. Ites. We say ites, right? Rastafari, we say aya, ites. So Rama means height, and Beit El, Beit El or Beth El, it means house of God or house of El, house of Hayel. House of Hayel means house of power, but it's not just power. It means a overpowering. It means like an overcoming power. You know, it's like you ever like fight with somebody who's real vigorous, and even though you pin them down and you're like, yeah, I got you down right now. And it's like you think they're out, and then they find some way to, and they wind up almost pinning you down. That's the example of what Hayel is. You know what I'm saying? It's an overpowering power, but that's the same word hebraically, you know what I'm saying, from ancient times as the attribute, the chief attribute of the true source. That's what we get El, and the connection with Ethiopic is Hayel, right? So the book of Eli, you understand, is really the book of Haile, and the book of Haile is the book of the seven seals. You understand? That's the book of Haile Selassie, of Kedemawi Haile Selassie, the Metzahafik Kedusa, you understand, line of the tribe of Judah, Revelation 5:5, Ethiopia, Ark of the Covenant. But you know, some folks, they don't love the truth, so you tell them that, and they're going to do some foolishness instead of acknowledging it's right, because they don't have no facts, you understand, that disprove it, you understand, that are factual. Now, it says that this all took place, the Ramah, the Bethel, between Ramah, height, and the house of God, the house of the power, in Mount Ephraim. Now, Ephraim, it means doubly fruitful. And the root of it is Afar, the Afar. Now, remember Adam, right? Remember the eighth day Adam, right? The eighth day Adam was made from the dust, or the Afar, right? The Afar. Now, that is the same in the Hebrew. That is the same in the Ethiopic. That is the same in the Royal Amharic of the Metzhaf Kedus. So we have, you know, we have like a triple hit on that word, because this is what shows you that the language at one time was one. Like we have English, and we have the Yankee speak like this, and the Yardi speak like that, and the next one speak like this and that. You know what I'm saying? So, but they're all still speaking a similar language, but each in their own particular dialects. Now, we don't call that different languages. We call that different ways of speaking the same language. That's the same thing when we're talking about the Afro-Shemitic, the Biblical Hebrew, the Ethiopic, and, of course, the pure language of Zephaniah chapter 3, verses 9 to 10, which is the Metzhaf Kedus. It says, for then, you understand, will he turn to the people a pure language, that they all may call upon the name of the Lord to serve him with one consent. You know what I'm saying? So that's unity. That's the key of unity. That's our divine heritage. All right? So let's go forward right here. So now we know where she dwelt, where Deborah dwelt, under the palm tree of Deborah, between the height, Ramah, and the house of El, the house of God, Bethel or Betel, in Mount Ephraim, a mountain, Mount Ephraim, which means doubly fruitful. It's not just fruitful, so Afar, you understand, also that sense of fruitfulness, right? It says, when the inner intuitive judgment and the directive power in understanding are rightly joined, when the intuitive judgment, your intuitive judgment, not condemnation, not acquitting everything, you know, saying nobody, everybody's wrong, everybody's right, not acquitting and not condemning, you know, just judging things, but just the power to just weigh in balance, right? That intuition, that intuitive judgment, and the directive power, right, in understanding are rightly joined, then victory over the enemies of the children of Israel, the enemies of the Dekika Israel, follows, right? And the children of Israel, what do they represent? Now, we know in the physical, in the flesh, we are the once lost but now found Beta Israel, so-called Negroes, Blacks, and Coloreds. In this dispensation are those flesh, are those children of Israel, or the children of the Lord's sheep. Now, but on the spiritual level, right, that we have to also recognize who we are, but also recognize the spiritual, you understand, the spiritual overstanding, because that is our inheritance if we receive it into that debir, into that innermost sanctuary, as a central, you understand, as a central, like as a foundation. You understand? So the children of Israel, they represent the real, the real, the enduring spiritual thoughts, the enduring spiritual thoughts. And the enemies of the children. Now, remember the part that we was reading in First Epistle of John, chapter 4. It was saying that little children, speaking to us as little children. So here we have the children of Israel, that our enemies, right, our satanat, are the material and the transitory thoughts, like the fickle, the transitory, the fleeting kind of stuff, right? Barak, he is the executiveness of the will. Now, the general of the armies of Israel should not go into action without good judgment. Remember when he asked Deborah to go with him? So Deborah, that bee, she represents good judgment. But now notice how this extends from the innermost, the sanctuary, and then notice how that is connected to the word, the logos. You see how all that works together? You know what I'm saying? So it paints for us a picture, like a word picture, where the word now begins to paint a picture, and then we can see how it applies within us and also around us in the real world, and then we begin to see the true spiritual matrix. We see the word written, you know what I'm saying? We see through this illusion, all right? So the only way to overcome the opposition of the adverse thought realm, because there's an adverse thought realm. I mean, I can just ask y'all, have you ever thought a negative thought when you didn't want and just comes out, pops out of nowhere, and you're like, oh, why am I thinking this? Why such and such? You know what I'm saying? So there's an adverse thought realm. And all the way to overcome that opposition is to understand. It's overstanding, right? It's to understand the law. That means to overstand the Orit, to overstand Torah. Because Christ, Yeshua, he is the living Torah. You know what I'm saying? He's the living example. We could not live it because we had no example, but moreover, we didn't have that grace. You know what I'm saying? We didn't have that forgiveness of our hatiyat, that forgiveness of that stain of the fallen black man or the fallen Adam, right? The fallen Adam, right? So the only way to overcome the opposition of the adverse, the negative thought realm is to understand the law and to keep constantly unified. That's tawahido. That's the mawahad. Like I say, digest it, to become one, to fuse it. The tawahido, that fusion, that becoming one, to keep constantly unified with good judgment. With good judgment, right? Which is based upon inner discrimination. You understand? In other words, you've got to clear yourself before you can go, you know, and judge. That's what Christ was teaching the disciples. He said, take the beam out your own eye before you remove the speck in your brother's eye. You understand? In other words, we first had to, that judgment had to be based upon the inner discrimination. Now, this is represented by Deborah, right, and her accompanying Barak, right, to battle. So the role of woman in a time of judges, I mean, I don't see nothing sexist about that. In fact, he knew he wouldn't have no victory if that woman did not accompany him into the battle. You see, in a lot of places, a lot of guys out there who don't really study and show themselves approved as they should, they'll see the parts where it talk about women should keep silent in church, woman this, woman that. And they think that, when even saying some about silly woman led astray, they think it's only talking about physical woman. That's because they're not getting the main point that the word, which is spiritual, became flesh. They're looking at the flesh becoming the word. So they're looking at it backward. They're trying to reverse engineer the word instead of starting with Yeshua first, instead of starting with Christ first, instead of starting with the true teaching of His Majesty, which is the true good news of the King of Kings and its Christ, seeking first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, which is our black Lord and Savior, Yeshua HaMashiach, in spirit and in truth. You know what I'm saying? That's what some might, who might have it spiritually, that means they walk out, they try to do, and, you know, and they're inclined to live their life in a true Christian way. They might still, you know, be looking at Peckerwood Jesus, and, you know, one would say, well, how come that happened? Because Jah is not partial. He knows their hearts. He knows that, you know, He knows His creatures. But we shouldn't be looking at what about them, like Peter did, We should really be thinking about how we either are being fed, you know what I'm saying, and whether we are eating, you know what I'm saying, and also if we are feeders, about feeding his sheep, you understand, feeding his sheep and not feeding the sheep cheap, you know what I'm saying? So it says, now, this is represented by Deborah. She accompanied Barak to battle, and it says, see Barak here, right, which is another off point, yeah, not off point, but another connective point right here. You can look up Barak and then get a clear idea about Deborah. But we're just explaining this connection as it pertains to the book of Deuteronomy, which is called the repetition of the law. It's like, you ever feel like, they say, you ever feel like deja vu? You ever feel like, wow, this is like happening again? You know, we've been here before. We're going through this again. You know, even though you say, well, I don't remember, you know, going through this before, but it feels like this is like deja vu. Well, the repetition of the law. We have to understand what's the real importance of this particular book, especially in our Torah studies. The victory, it belongs to the intuitive judgment and not to the will. See, one say, do what thou wilt shall be all of the law. We say, nah, 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 because the real victory, it belongs to the intuitive judgment. You understand? The intuitive judgment, you know what I'm saying? And it's not to the will. You understand? Because you can make your will, you can put your will on negative things, like His Majesty teach I and I that to make our wills obedient to good influences is to show the greatest wisdom. But in order to accomplish that, one must be guided by living faith, by the hymenote, poorly translated in English as religion. But when we look at the word religion, we're going to our palm tree. You remember Deborah? She sat on the home palm tree. So we're not defining it by Western, white, Eurocentric, Gentile custom. We understand where they're coming from, you know what I'm saying? So we can see them go back to where they come from unless they repent. But we are going to look at our own root and truth. That's what we're building on our own foundation. It reminds me of the Aryan scripture where it says that, and everybody shall worship their gods. I think it's in the book of Micah. But like we'll walk in their gods, but we're going to walk in the name of our God. You know what I'm saying? So they can walk after their own, you know, whatever. You know what I'm saying? But if we know the truth, that's what we should do. Now, in mixed states of consciousness, in mixed states, this is what we call mixed up moods and attitudes. You know, yeah, brothers and sisters got their mixed up moods and attitudes. Yeah. Well, that's a mixed state of consciousness. You know, it's like you get a little bit here, but you got this demon over there that you can't seem to cast out because you don't trust in Yeshua. He's the one that casts that out. So as you build your house on that foundation, you know what I'm saying, that drives these forces out, this mixed state. But it says in mixed states of consciousness where to appearances, error is strongest. Because people say, Raj, you don't understand. The evildoers are so strong. I just saw a video. All right. In mixed states of consciousness, where to appearances, error is strong. I was watching something, and they said something about appearances being stronger than reality. You know, like appearances are, they say appearances are deceptive, but they don't say it too much nowadays because they're using that to deceive a lot of people where, it, according to appearances, error seems to be stronger. So people say, what can you do about it? It is by following the intuitive leadings of the Spirit. The intuitive leadings of the Spirit that the way to the light, the way to the illumination, the true illumination is opened up. When we are confronted with a problem, the very first thing to be done is to consult our inner discrimination or guidance. We also must affirm that this intuitional faculty, that the intuitional faculty is functioning in its native state in perfect unison with infinite wisdom. You know, it's like, that's what it says, know thyself. You understand? Know thyself. You see, and the people that most don't know themselves is the lost sheeple. You said, but then, get this, they are the key to the whole divine prophetic equation. And I'm speaking about the lost sheeple, black people. They wonder why so much is against them. because they don't know who they are. If they knew who they are, many of their enemies would step back. You understand? Because once they know that, if you know you're bait to Israel and you're children of God, you understand? I mean, they got to step back for a moment. You understand? Because they know that now higher powers are now into this equation. You understand? But once they know that the lost sheeple are lost sheeple, they know you are cut off. You've cut yourself off from your native state. Like when you hear folks say, I ain't no African. I ain't no Ethiopian. I ain't from over there. I'm from my block, you know, but I moved, so I'm from this block. You know, some crazy stuff. You see what I'm saying? So they're not connected with their native state. So they can't be in a perfect unison. So in that state, nothing is perfect. Therefore, they don't have infinite wisdom. They have finite wisdom, and the finite wisdom is what we see in the world. This technology is wisdom. Wisdom equals technology. Plain and simple, if you want to understand it in real time, the wisdom of the world is the technology. But that's finite, that's limited. You know, understand it's subject to a lot of crashes and stuff like that. Now, but this is not enough. Even on the proper level, that is not enough. We must insist that this same discerning spirit of divine wisdom accompany us every step of the way. That's why Proverbs says that wisdom is the principal thing. It's the main thing. When we first receive Makebel, Kabbalah, a spiritual inspiration as to how to meet a situation, we often feel assured of our ability to succeed. You know, when we first get, oh, yeah, that's what I'm going to do about it. Yeah, that's what I'm going to do. We feel confident, right? But, however, on the other hand, again, as the matter progresses, as whatever situation we're in progresses, certain aspects change and new aspects develop. You know, like when it says, like, it's a moving picture, there's many moving parts. Other things develop. So we must be in conscious contact with the wise discrimination at every step of the way that we may attain complete success. All right? Now, that right there was just going over, you know what I'm saying, going over this particular link right here with Deborah. So we see the word, the logistics, but then you also need the wisdom. You need the tactics in order to achieve, you know what I'm saying, the objective. So you have to ask oneself, well, what is, you know what I'm saying, what is that will all about? That's why the will has to be read. You understand? And in some cases, one has to have good consultation about the will because it might have language that you might not understand, that you don't use in your everyday life. You understand? But it's interesting how we would do that with a physical thing, a temporary thing, you know what I mean, temporary wealth, and we will almost totally ignore it with the spiritual wealth. Now, here's I want to throw in Tabor, not throw in, but I want to put in Mount Tabor, right? Down here, I want to put in T-A-B-O-R. Now, people say, well, that's Tabor. That's not Debar. That's not that. Yes, it is. Because in ancient Egypt, they didn't use the D. Like, instead of Dawit or Tahuti, it became Tahuti. Right, like Tut, Tahuti. Instead of Debar or Debir, they had Tabor in ancient Egypt. So if you study hieroglyphs, they basically will, you'll basically see that the D wasn't used in their particular dialectical. But if we look in the same metaphysical Bible dictionary, and in the Hebrew here, it says that Tabor means heaped up, it means highest part. It means a height. It means a summit. Remember, as Master said, that we reach the summit destined for us by the great creator. The summit, the umbilicus, like the umbilical cord, the navel, i.e., the height of the belly. In other words, the navel in the sense that the navel is the height of the belly. A mound, a hill, a mountain. Now, in biblical language, right, a hill or a mountain, which if I drew right here, if I had the, if you draw a hill or a mountain, let's understand this symbologically, because for some who were not readers, the teachers had to use symbols, right? And from that we get hieroglyphs, and then we get these stories that they call mythologies, you understand, or parables. If you look at this right here, this is like a pyramid, right? But then at the same time, it is a mountain. It's a symbol of a mountain. You understand? It's a symbol of a mountain. So we get to see that height. We can now put this, if we can put this together. All right? Now, it's interesting when you look at the beehive, and actually if you put six of these together, right, six of these together, the inside, the six-pointed star, right, you will have at the inside of the six-pointed star, you will have like I think the beehive is in the same sort of hexagonal kind of shape, if I'm correct. So there's a likeness, mountain, sanctuary, inner part. So in the inner part of a six-pointed star, you find like what is like that beehive, you know, honeycomb kind of a shape. But now, going further, Tabor was a mountain in Palestine on the border of Issachar. That's interesting too, because we know as far as nationality for the black Hebrews or the Ethiopian Hebrews of this diaspora, that links with Mexico. And that's in Joshua 19:22. Now, it was from this mountain that Barak, he went to defeat Sisera. Now, see, I didn't even really peep that. That was from this mountain that Barak, we just read about in Deborah. I was just following that intuition right there. I now see a further link. I was thinking about with Yeshua on Mount Tabor and the Mount of Transfiguration, so forth, and so on, but it says that it was from this mountain that Barak, which some say is like lightning or something, he went to defeat Sisera and the army of Jabin, the king of Canaan, in Judges 4 and 6, verse 12 and 14. Now they say that it's the name of a Levitical city. There was a Levitical city of Zebulun, and we've been speaking about Zebulun as well from Psalm 68. Where it speaks about the, you know, there's little Benjamin and her ruler and the princes of Judah. And then it mentions of Zebulun. And Zebulun, according to the 12 tribes nationality, that would be, Guatemala, that's Panama. That was Panama to, was it Guatemala to Panama? Because Naphtali is Argentine to Chile, and Argentine is, I think, the Arua Canians, right, as the ancient people, part of the dispersed Beta Israel. Remember, the 10 tribes were dispersed, and they even say how the Eskimos and the Indians, some of them came across, you understand, that region from the opposite side. Now, of course, some say the 10 tribes were destroyed, but Josh says that they were scattered throughout the four corners of the world. So we find in the early days of like the 1800s and so forth and so on, there were white Christian European missionaries who were finding Israelites or Jews, they said, of all nations, you know, of the Koreans, of Asians, of Indians. And then eventually they get to find the Beta Israel in Ethiopia and other parts. They will find them all over. The question I ask is, what happened to all these people? I remember some of the numbers in some of these books from the 1800s. I know what a lot of people would say, but hopefully some of them were, you know, were able to survive, but to fulfill even John's word. Remember, not just over here in this hemisphere, but we have to know who we are, where we're at. So anyway, it's the name of a Levitical city of Zebulun in 1 Chronicles 6 and 77. Now, there was an oak, like an oak tree, or Elion, an Alon of Tabor, that is mentioned in 1 Samuel 10 and 3. Now, the reference here is believed to be a grove of oak trees on or near the border of Binyam, on or near the border of Benjamin. So once again, we have, you know, like I was saying, I wanted to get into the tribes a little bit more. The Spirit said, the Holy Spirit said, deal with this lesson. You understand? Deal with this lesson. And I'm so happy that I and I have been obedient to this lesson. I just testify to what Abba Kadosh, in the name of Yeshua, you understand, is revealing even by going through this lesson with you all. Because I didn't plan to go into Tabor for that link there. And knowing that Tabor links with this etymologically, you know, the Spirit said, go there. I and I so happy that I and I was obedient and I and I went there. So it's another example of that intuition being guided by His wisdom. So here in verse 27, it says, there's little Benjamin with their ruler, the princes of Judah and their council, and the princes of Zebulun, and the princes of Naphtali. So when we first was going over this, we say, okay, Benjamin, if Benjamin is Guyana and Jamaica, you understand, and in the Rastafari sense, we can say Jamaica is there with that ruler. You understand? Whether we look at it as the Bob Marley vibe, you know, or that Rasta and reggae vibe, that's kind of that ruler from Little Benjamin, from that Little Island. And then it says the princes of Judah. You understand? And Judah is a so-called Afro-American Negro, or black man, or African-American, Afro-American, right? And their council. So we immediately made a link between that and between the EWF, or the Ethiopian World Federation, right? The Ethiopian World Federation, we immediately made a link there as well, because that link is very important, whether we want to call it the executive council, so forth and so on. And if we want to know why things are not working out according to the divine heritage, we have to ask, right, are we in the divine heritage? Are we operating in according to that? Or are we trying to do our will instead of doing His will and recognizing who we are? That's why even this book on this brother right here, Dr. Malako Emmanuel Bayan, we've been speaking about, because it's very important even for the Judahites, you know, saying the so-called Afro-American, you know, saying whether they are of the Hebrew Israelites, whether Ethiopian Hebrews, Rastafari, or any other of the, you know, my father's house, there are many mansions, but truth is truth. You understand? So we got to recognize that. Then I went on to say, well, who is Zebulun? And who is Naphtali? And then, you know, John is just blessing I and I with certain links and contacts among different brothers and sisters out there. And then we're noticing just the vibe. It's like just all moving in and according to His will. And we're checking out, well, where are you from? Oh, you're from Argentina, word for real. And next one, well, one's communicating from Chile, you know what I mean, on level. And then you're like, wait, what about Guatemala, you understand, and Panama, you know, and it's like, wow, it's like you begin then to see even Isachar or Issachar, which according to the 12 tribes, right, of the Hebrew Israelites, that would be that remnant among the Mexico. You know, so there's a very important overstanding to recognize, because there's many of our Afro-American, Afro-Caribbean, Afro-Hispanic brothers and sisters who have been called out of darkness to the light of the King of Kings and His Christ. Now, you know, this is why we have to be born again and allow that inward conception to come to full birth. You understand? To the glory of Abba, Father, in the name and through the word, sound, and power of Yeshua HaMashiach. See, that's when we connect with Source. So a lot of these other confusions will be put to the side. Because when we look at this, let's go on. It says, thy God hath commanded thy strength. That Jah commands our strength. He says, strengthen, O God, Abirtu, I Father, His Father, O Father of the house, Abirtu, that which thou has wrought for us. So notice what it's saying. We're asking Abirtu, I Father. He's I and I Father. He's our Abba. You understand? He's His Father. He's Yeshua HaMashiach's, right? He's Christ's father. He's the father of the house. He's the father of Beta Israel. He is the father of those of the new name of the Beta Rastafari. So we're asking him to strengthen what? Strengthen what we want to do, our wills? No. Strengthen what he has wrought, what he has already done for I and I. Because we're living in a time where it seems like the foundations are being broken down. You always wonder what's going to happen to the Federation. What's up with this? Will these ones get off of this kind of, you know, this other stuff and recognize what Jah has already wrought for I and I? You always saying stop being disobedient and going against the divine heritage? You always saying to study and show themselves approved? It says, because of thy temple at Jerusalem shall kings bring presents to thee. And I just have to mention this with Brother Raz Siddiqui, and this is a brother that has been chosen by some of the priests, you understand, especially the guardian priests of the Ark Sanctuary, to build a new house, you understand, a new, you could say, house, temple, sanctuary for the Ark of the Covenant. And all we have to do, you understand, is just to be of a willing heart, just like the Beta Israel, the Israelites were of a willing heart, you understand, and they gave towards it. You understand? Even if one has that widow's mite, even that widow's mite. So check out the vid when we speak about endorsing, and not just endorsing, but really supporting that project. So those who have faith and trust I and I word, check out the information for yourself. And even if it's a little something, people might be like, I only got a couple of dollars or whatever. Even that little something, you understand, is very important towards this effort, because Jah, he will strengthen, as it says right here, he will strengthen that which he has done for us. Verse 29, I'm in Psalm 68. It says, because of thy temple at Jerusalem shall kings bring presents to thee. It says, rebuke the company of spearmen. The spearmen are like the one that we could say gunmen. You're right, the gunmen. Rebuke the company of the gunmen. Rebuke them. We're not asking man, we're asking Jah to do it. You understand? For his son's namesake, and for I and I namesake. Rebuke the company of spearmen, the multitude of bulls. You know, bull is symbolic of that stubbornness. You understand? On one level, it's that stubbornness of these bulls with the calves of the people. You understand? With the calves of the people. Till everyone, right, to what? Till everyone submit himself with what? With pieces of silver. Now, this article that we just seen about Haile Selassie and Kennedy and silver and the economy and prophecy, you got to check that out. You got to check that out. We're going to try to maybe post it or, you know, repost it either on the Facebook page, try to get it out to the eye of them so at least the eye of them can, you know, check it out for yourself. But it says right here, till everyone submit himself with pieces of silver. Scatter thou the people that delight in war. Those who delight in war. I'm a warrior. Wah, 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 wah. Nah, you're going to be scattered. You understand? Because Jah don't want that. You understand? He don't want people to delight in war. You understand? When they bring war to I and I door, you understand? Just as His Majesty shows us that example, you understand? We are confident in the victory of good over evil. But we're not like these, you know, watch being like the world. And here's where it gets to verse 31. It says, princes shall come out of Egypt. Ethiopia shall soon stretch out her hands to God. Now, actually, Bamarinya in the Met of Kedus of Negus and Neges, that idea of soon is not really there. It's more that Ethiopia shall stretch out, or Ethiopia stretches out. So it's not so much just in a futuristic sense. It's almost like she was stretching out her hands even in the time of David. You know what I'm saying? Looking forward to that connection, to that unification of the family. It's like Ethiopians at home and Ethiopians abroad. You know what I'm saying? And we scattered all over. You know what I'm saying? Sing to Jah. Sing to Jah. So we have reggae music. We have the roots music. Singing to Jah. Not singing to Gal, singing to Bobby, Bobby, Baby, Baby, Babylon. You understand? Baby Babylon. No, singing to Jah. Singing to Ha Elohim. You know what I'm saying? Singing to Yeshua. Ye kingdoms of the earth. So we're supposed to be chanting this, telling the nations, you better start singing praises to God. So when they start seeing certain signs, some of them might be saved. Right? Because they will have been warned. Because of that confession of the mouth towards salvation. You understand? Oh, sing praises to Adonai, to Adoni, Selah, to him that rideth upon the what? He rides upon the heaven of heavens. Right? They said there's Nibiru. There's strange signs out there. You know, they said these are extraterrestrial, the aliens. Ooh, monsters. How we know they're not Jah's angels? I mean, think about it for a moment. I remember who's telling us these things, right? To him that rideth upon the heaven of heavens, which were of old. They were of old. These are old time things. It looked like new, or look what we discovered, but then they found these things are, who can say this here or that is new? Lo, he doth send out his voice, and that a mighty voice. It says, ascribe ye strength, chayil, strength, to Ha Elohim. His excellency, like his majesty, is over Israel. You understand? Remember, the 10 tribes didn't want to submit, right, to David. You got to really check that and see how even among many of the Israelites, they don't want to submit themselves to the King of Kings and his Christ. We really have, I mean, they know the Israelites and such, but they don't want to, they don't have a, if they have a love of the truth, they'll recognize the evidence, because the evidence cannot be confounded or refuted. Because many of us, we wasn't in this state when we were searching out things. We were trying to find the truth. We didn't know whether the information and the evidence was going to affirm what we found out about the King of Kings, Haile Selassie, or not, but we kept finding affirmation, affirmation, more revelation, revelation, affirmation. I mean, and having a love for the truth, yo, you just have to accept the truth. But some don't want to hear that because they already on their preset. They are, they have a zeal for God, but it's not according to knowledge. They're seeking to establish their own righteousness. And any other righteousness than the righteousness of the King of Kings and his Christ is self-righteousness, and that is bound to fail. But we are to ascribe strength to Ha Elohim, to Jah, if you please. His excellency is over Israel, and his strength is in the clouds. His strength is in the clouds. Now, when you put it all together, the heavens of heavens, 2012, his strength is in the clouds. You have to really decide, meditate on that, and decide what will you accept as being true from what you, from the evidence that you have. It says, Abetu, O Father, I Father, O Father of the house, Abetu, thou art terrible. You are what? You are terrible out of thy holy places. And what's the holy place? The Debir. You understand? And where's the Debir in us? Right? It's that heart. It's that word being in our innermost of our inner. It's David saying, I have hidden this word like within me so that I will not sin against you. When you have that word in you, that word is a living being. It is Christ. That word is a living word. Once you are able to eat that word spiritually from the dead book. See, the book is dead. The book got no power. It's dead. But we are the living man. And in Christ and through Christ, this word become a living word for us. So that same God, that same Father, he is terrible out of the holy places, right? The God of Israel, El Elohe Israel, is he that giveth what? What does he give to his people? Strength. And what does he give to his people? Power. He gives what? Strength and power. Some people say, what about money? Listen, if you have strength and power, then you know the earth is the Lord's and the fullness is thereof. You know, we can make money, this lighter, we can make money, this piece of paper right here, we can make money, just the word money. You know, money, you know, I got money, money. You know, all right, cool. You know what I mean? When you overstand it, the main thing is having that strength and that power. But if you give the appearances and the error. You empower that with your own living energy, being in fear and torment of it. You're never going to be in the God of peace to overcome, you understand, to overcome this evil, you understand, and the evildoers by the Prince of Peace. You understand? And this doesn't mean that, you know, we just stand down, you understand, in a day of battle. But first you have to be spiritually grounded, otherwise you're going to short circuit. All right? So he giveth strength and power to his people. And then it concludes with, blessed be God, blessed be Jah, blessed be the God and Father of our black Lord and Savior Yeshua, HaMoshiach. So we wanted to touch a little more on that Devarim. So what do we understand? Let's just summarize for a moment. Devarim means the words, right? It's a Hebrew, you understand? It's the Hebrew for the book of Deuteronomy, the Hebrew book of Deuteronomy. In the Ethiopic, it's called Orit, the Torah, as it were, Ze of Dagim. Dagim means the repetition from the Ethiopic root Degemen. Degemen, to repeat, of the repetition. Now, Devar means word, right? Devar means word, but Devar also means, right? Devar also means, I want you to understand, it's the Logos. And from that word logos, you know, we get logic. You understand? And if it's not logical, it is illogical. It is ill. So our people have been ill because they haven't been on the logos. You understand? And some of them in a mixed state of consciousness, they are illogical. You understand? They are illogical. You understand? But now when you drop that ill off it and just deal with the purity of it, it's the logos, it's the word, right? And now we learn that Debir, like the Ethiopic Deber and Deberet, which mean a mountain of Deber Damo, the mountain or the monastery of Damo. Now Tabor is very interesting as well, because Tabor is also known or called, in certain Christian circles, the Mount of Transfiguration. The Mount of Transfiguration. Now, what I want you to get is how the word is connected with this. So we have Tabor here, the Mount of Transfiguration. All right? Then we have right here, let's see what else, the Mount of Transfiguration. Oh, we didn't miss. Did we or didn't we? Where did we stop right here? We didn't go through this? We didn't go through this, people? Yikuta. My bad. Metaphysical. Yeah, we stopped at Benjamin, but we didn't go to the metaphysical. So let's just get into the metaphysical right here. On Tabor, right? The metaphysical is that it's a high place in consciousness. It's a high height in consciousness. So even when we look at this pyramid, where is that height? Now, here's how the devil disempowers you. You're looking at this symbology, and the only way you can interpret this is through the devil's illogicalness. Because remember, you have like Christ and Antichrist. You have logic, and you have illogic. You see what I'm saying? So people are looking at this as though symbols do not belong to the devil, words don't belong to him. But what he does, he makes you believe it by appearances, you understand, and error thoughts. You understand? And we fear these things, and we give them power, and we reaffirm. It's like a spell. You understand? He says he's greater than Jah. He could do more things than Jah. He controlled everything. We have no choice of it. And then you repeat it. It's like you're under a spell. You understand? Because you're not in the word. Because you really cannot spell the word. You don't understand the word. And once you can spell the word and know what the word is, and you put it into that sanctuary, and the Debir, you understand, like the monastery, is the sanctuary, is the heart. Now, Deborah is interesting, since it's from that same root, because that B, you understand, that B is very active. You understand? That B, it has discernment. You know how the B will go to different flowers, so forth and so on. You understand? So that is being spiritually guided. They even did studies on how the B move on certain winds. You know how the bee moves on certain invisible winds and stuff like that. And it's just all very telling. I know the ancients understood this. So when they gave us this code in the scriptures, you know, then they probably hoped, they prayed that there'll be a generation. Because one time they didn't have to have books. But because man became forgetful and it was known that man would need this sefer, need this instruction, right? The books and the instruction in time to come, we give thanks and praise for the book of the seven seals. We give thanks and praise for the Holy Spirit. You understand? And for our brothers and our sisters in Adonai, in Yeshua HaMoshiach. So Tabor, let's just conclude this right here on Tabor and connect all this, all these dots right here. That the high place is a high place in consciousness. Not a low place, that's a Kana'anu, but it's a high place in consciousness. It's a very exalted group of thoughts. Notice, it's not just a thought, but it's a very exalted group, right, of thoughts or thought center in the idea of heaped up, highest part, height, summit, mountain. And for I and I, Rastafari brothers and sisters, recall to mind when imagine the summit destined for us by the great creator. Think about that in this connection right here, right? It's a mountain in Palestine, a Levitical city, and a grove of oak trees. Oaks, right? The oak tree, the symbolism of the tree, it denotes in the Bible great strength and protection. Bamarinya, we call it the Adbar Zaf. The Adbar Zaf, right? Now, Tabor and Hermon. Tabor and Hermon, they rejoice in thy name. Right? This is a quote. Mountains always stand for thoughts of a lofty character. Right? And that's it's kind of short right here on Tabor. You understand? And I don't know why I didn't go into the Mount of Transfiguration here, but I know from Ethiopic sources that mountain, the Mountain of Transfiguration, is identified with Mount Tabor. But then the word Tabor, some say it might have become a generic term for mountain. But now what's interesting is how we have mountain connected with a bee, connected with the Debir, the innermost sanctuary, the inner sanctum, or the Holy of Holies. You know what I'm saying? It's the Debir. Right? Then we have Devar, right? Or a Devar, even the Devar of the Orit or the Torah, which is the reasoning on it. Because remember in Mikrab, or what they may call the synagogue, or in the Hebraic Judaic gathering, usually what we do and would do for our, you will call it service, would be reading the Torah portion. That's ones would get the honor to come up to read Yosef from the holy language, a portion of the, you know, a portion of that particular Torah reading. But then usually afterwards, they would have what is called a devar, right? A devar. And usually you'll find it spelled D-V-A-R instead of D-E-V-A-R, but D-V-A-R. So it's like a reasoning, it's like a sermon, it's like a lecture, or like a fakare, you understand, on that particular subject matter. And hopefully we'll get to speak a little more about the fakare Yesus, and hopefully we'll have that published shortly. So there is an application here, and I hope and pray that ones would be able to study this and listen to this and take some good notes out, and also check out some of these resources. You understand, for themselves. We have more of them at the website, www.lojsociety.org. So please check that out. And before we go forward, hopefully let's see if we can put a prayer to one of I and I favorite kind of doxologies, like a missa, a closing prayer. That's what the Haftarah would be in the sabbatical Torah. But we find that this this word right here is a very strengthening word for us. It's an encouragement, and this is from Jude, you understand, which is the general epistle of Jude, or Judah, Yehuda, right? The better sense and truer sense of Judas, because the part about Judas was the Iscariot part, but we'll touch on that another time, y'all willing. But here is for the true Mitmanon, the true and faithful are assured, that we're assured and we're comforted, and there's a sevenfold duty. But ye beloved, my brothers and sisters, in Christ, the glory of Abba, Father, Abba, Kedus, Kedus, Abba, Tachin, building up yourselves, may we build up I and I selves on I and I most holy faith, on the Ritua Hymenot, on the true Tawahido, overstanding, praying in the Menfes Kedus, praying in the Holy Spirit, not a ghost, in the Holy Spirit, the Ruach HaKodesh. Keep yourselves in the love of God. Now notice there's a responsibility for we to do that. We must keep ourselves. If we let ourselves go, you understand, if we let go of ourselves and we fall out of that, that's our doing, that's not Jah doing. We have to keep ourselves in the love of Jah. And it says the love of Jah is keeping his commandment, and the commandment is to love one another. Yehovah's looking for the mercy of Adonenu Gitachin Jesus Christos, or Adonenu Yeshua HaMoshiach, to eternal life. And of some have compassion, brothers and sisters, making a difference, and others save with fear, with reverence, pulling them out of the fire, hating even the garment spotted by the flesh. You know, that word there is very important at this time when we have many ones seeking Rastafari, even though we know that they have been doing a lot of other things. It's like their garment, their earthly life is like spotted by flesh, by the carnal living. So they have to be saved with a sure fear and a reverence. They have to understand that Rastafari, true Rastafari, is no joke. You understand, this is not a game and this is not a joke in that worldly sense. It is not. Now to him that is able to keep you, to keep I and I from falling to the wiles of Diablos, of Satan, of the worldly, and even the unmortified parts that we have to mortify, and to present all of I and I faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy. This is the joy of Jah, is I and I's strength. To the only wise God, the only wise God. There might be many gods and lords, but there's the only one wise God, and that's the God and Father, our Black Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Our Savior, be glory and majesty, dominion and power, both now and ever. Amen and amen. Brothers and sisters, I love the I in the name of the King of Kings, Kadamawi Haile Selassie, and his Christ, our Black Lord and Savior, Yeshua HaMoshiach. So shalom in the Rastafari home. Be well, my brothers and sisters. Shalom. May Yeshua's peace be with you and in you, both now and forevermore.